That's a loaded pizza with the cheese, with the stuffing. Have a couple of slices of this, and that's pretty much your main course in a meal here. Oh wow, this one certainly looks pretty, and this is the unbelievable apple. So this is happens every 30 minutes.
Every 30 minutes, so 40 yeah. hands again, 20 seconds.
So yeah. this is a practice across all the kitchens, everywhere it's happening.
Dry your hand, sanitize your hand, then you go back into your workstation.
Hi folks, hope you're doing well. We are in day 2 of Unlock 1 here in India. Well, most stores that we see around have opened. They're opening after nearly 3 months of closure. I guess they've taken, or they will perhaps take, their own safety precautions, and I hope they do, because sometimes when things open up, people tend to forget why we'd gone into a lockdown in the first place. So I can also see some malls that have opened. I just passed a mall here in Koramangala, and they seem to have a sanitation tunnel that you have to walk in through before you step into the mall. Also, restaurants have begun to open. Not all restaurants, but a few that have managed to, you know, get their processes to handle things, to handle customers, to handle service in the new normal. Those are the restaurants that have opened. And speaking of restaurants, you also have five-star restaurants, restaurants in five-star hotels that have reopened. And today, we're on our way to dine in at one such restaurant. So we're on our way to the Oberoi Bengaluru to not just dine in at their all-day dining restaurant, their coffee shop, which is called Lapis. But I also want to take a look at the steps that the Oberoi Bengaluru has taken to ensure that people can dine in safely and with complete peace of mind. So as you drive in, not only does your car get checked, but it also gets sanitized. Well, here we are at the Oberoi Bengaluru. Thank you. So as you walk in, not only do your hands get sanitized, but also your bag gets sanitized. Of course, after the security check. Namaste.
Hi, Kripal.
How are you doing,
Welcome
Rishi?
Welcome back to reality.
The new reality.
The new reality, yes. It's great to have you here.
Thank you for inviting me over to take a look at what's happening at the Oberoi Bengaluru.
It's a pleasure.
So I am with Mr. Visheshwar Raj Singh, who's a general manager of the Oberoi Bengaluru. So Vishi, it's a very different world.
Yes, we're all adapting to it and okay. We're learning as we go along. We had a good team of about 40 people staying in the hotel.
Okay.
And we were running a home delivery service, which it occurred to us pretty early on that guests would not be going out and, you know, you get bored of home food after a certain amount of time.
So the hotel never really closed?
Not really, no. We had actually three guests who got stuck with us when the lockdown occurred, and they were not from, you know, local guests. They were from overseas.
So you had to keep the services going for three guests.
We had to keep everything going for three rooms.
Wow. You're 160 rooms.
So three out of 160 is less than 2%, I guess.
But you still had to keep the hotel going. So that speaks commitment in terms of commitment towards your guests.
Absolutely.
Even in public spaces, I can also see that
we've spread out the seating.
It's distanced.
Yes. We've reduced the number of chairs. We put signs there at reception that if the desk is occupied, please wait here. So there are little touches everywhere. Those doors are always going to be kept open. One shutter of every door is kept open, even
all
on
right.
this side. So you don't have to touch the handle every time you're coming in.
Oh, all right.
And of course, we've got sanitizers at every possible place, right at the entry point and the bell desk and reception. Every elevator, not more than 2 people. And because that's the distance, we need about 5 to 6 feet. How do you maintain basic hygiene?
So basically, everything has changed.
Oh yes, I think
it's a new world.
It's all about communicating what we can do to reassure people that we have their safety and their well-being in mind.
And I think that needs to probably, you need to remind people constantly, right? Because the natural instinct for people is to always come together.
That's right.
Right? So of course, the one aspect of the Oberoi Bengaluru is the fact that you have plenty of open space.
Correct, that's really something special. And a lot of lung space, as you say, in the center of the city.
Even if you're dining in here, you're not really in an air-conditioned environment. You've got plenty of fresh air that's coming in, so...
All I like to say, all our restaurants are naturally air-conditioned. and okay. we're running the air conditioning as per government norms. We have to run it at 24 degrees, so we're still running it at the background at 24 degrees. The idea is to just make sure that there's no stillness in the air, that there's movement.
Okay.
And you know, the lower the temperature, also our human body tends to be more susceptible at lower temperatures.
Okay. So you want to warm things up at least by a couple of degrees.
Even here at the cloakrooms, no more than two people at a time. So if there are two people already in there, third person comes, they'll stop you. Please wait, there are two people already inside.
This is what I love about the Oberoi Bengaluru. It brings the glorious Bengaluru weather inside, and that's what they've managed to capture here. Wherever you are in the hotel, no matter where you are in the hotel, whether you're on a room or whether you're dining somewhere, you always have a view of the alfresco, of the glorious Bangalore outdoors.
If you remember, the old Asian restaurant was fully shut. There was
That's
only
right.
a door. So now we've completely opened it out. So there's a lot of air circulation.
So you basically want fresh air going into your restaurant.
The circulation has to happen.
What about the tables? Have your tables been socially distanced as
yes,
well?
Yes, what we've done is, if you see the red tent cards, they indicate that that table is not to be used. So we've only got every alternate table to be set up.
So basically you have guests sitting here and you have guests sitting all the way there.
That's right.
This of course is Wabi Sabi, which is the Asian restaurant.
Japanese and Chinese.
But
That's
today
right.
we're going to be dining at Lapis, which is their all-day dining restaurant. So again, you have social distanced
That's
tables.
Right. Every alternate table is blocked off. Towards the corridor, sorry, the passage side, this is where people will be passing by.
Oh, okay.
So we don't want people to sit close to where there's traffic. If you see, the covers are all away from the aisle.
Very warm welcome, Kripal.
Thank you very much. Great to be back.
It's really great that you have connected with us and giving us this platform to reach out to the audience to say that, you know, some things haven't changed. I think our personalization, our warmth, you know, our care for you as a diner has not changed.
So that's Pinky Padmaraj, and as you can guess, she's the official spokesperson for the Oberoi Bengaluru. Thank you for having me over to take a look at what's happening.
Our pleasure. And here's Chef Robin.
And that's Chef Robin Batra.
Welcome back.
Thank you very much. Who's the executive chef of the Oberoi Bengaluru? So Chef, a lot has changed when it comes to...
So I agree, in terms of hygiene and sanitization, I think there are a lot of new processes that are in place, and we are very, very confident that whatever we are producing in our kitchen is the best, and it makes us feel happy basically.
So no buffets now?
So no buffet for now.
Okay.
Our focus is primarily on a la carte menus.
So Chef, can we take a look at the kitchen and see what's happening?
Definitely, I'll show you a few of the practices that we are following.
So let's get into the kitchen here at the Oberoi Bengaluru to see how the chefs here have remodeled processes in the new normal.
This is a bell which regularly rings after every half an hour. Okay. When the team have to go, definitely they are doing their hand washes in between after handling every task. So you see the bell has rung, and now there are chefs coming in. So they will come one by one, maintaining social distancing, and they will all wash their hands.
So this is happens every 30 minutes?
Every 30 minutes. So wash their hands again, 20 seconds.
So this is a practice across
all the kitchens, everywhere it's happening. Dry your hands, sanitize your hand, then you go back into your workstations. So every single section has something like this, which is the sanitization tray. So your area is regularly washed after every hour, which is the regular cleaning, and on top of that you have Sumas, and which you keep on sanitizing your...
So every hour you're sanitizing
Every hour the kitchen is being sanitized now.
And what about the dishes, the pots and the pans that you use?
So after every use, they go back to the pot wash. They are washed first, then they are sanitized with Sumas and the similar liquid which I showed you. Then they come back to the kitchen.
So are these sanitizers food grade?
These are all food grade from Johnson University. So these all can be used in our areas.
Okay. And Chef, what about ingredients that come in? What about vegetables that come in, meats that come in?
Right.
How do you...
So we have a strict policy regarding the receiving as well.
Okay.
So we have issued vendor passes. So only few vendors are allowed to come inside. Most of the trucks or the people who are coming, they are at the main gate. They're not allowed entry inside.
So basically, there's already a three-step process there. Right. So you've got the truck or the vehicle that bought in the ingredients that's sanitized.
Right.
Then you've got the red trolley which comes to a certain point.
Right.
It gets sanitized, and again it comes back into the store
also,
area.
I will just take an example now for this particular dish. So the specialty that has come in, so the raw material has been sanitized when it has come in the hotel. we have some herbs, we have some fresh red chili, some garlic. So all perishables are being dipped in 50 ppm chlorine, sanitized, and then they come inside the kitchen.
So chef, I can see that he's not wearing gloves. So somebody who's
so
working
only,
on...
only people who are on the hot range or on the tandoor, because with the heat from the pan, the gloves can melt. So these are the people who are avoiding the gloves. But again, after every half an hour, they are regularly washing their hands and sanitizing. And after every use of once they have prepared one dish, they will go and they will sanitize their hands.
Okay.
So even the tasting also, when he will do, he will use the disposable spoon. So this is one of the another practice of doing the social distancing. So there's one on the tandoor, one on the hot plate, one on the gas range.
In the earlier setup, you would typically have about 5 or 6 people in this
area.
We
had 5 or 6 people.
So the social distancing is not just outside in the restaurant, but also in the kitchen. In addition to the hygiene and sanitation practices, the chefs are also following social distancing.
Sanitize your hand.
Okay.
You can keep your mask in this envelope, sir.
All right, mask in the envelope.
Yes.
It feels great to be taking the mask off when you're outside. We're so used to being with the mask on that it definitely feels like a lot of relief. I think now that the bags are sanitized, it's time to look at the menu. So you basically download the menu, scanning the QR code. You have the complete menu of the restaurant on your phone.
We also have it uploaded on our iPads.
Oh, okay.
The iPad gets sanitized after every use. So
that certainly helps when you have the menu on a larger screen. Well, the menu here is a mix of regional Indian, some Mediterranean and Italian. Now, it's been a while since I've dined out, and definitely been a while since I've dined out here at the Oberoi Bengaluru. So Tanmay, what I want to do is taste a bit of a few things. So I definitely want to taste the brulee of goat cheese.
Very well, sir.
The Karari Rumali Roti. And maybe one of the kebabs.
Sir, you can try Hyderabadi lamb tikki.
Lamb tikki.
Nice. We do very nice lamb tikki.
And that's made with mince?
Yes, it's minced lamb, sir.
Alright, so that sounds interesting. Let's do that. I think we should definitely try one of the deep dish pizza.
Try this, sir. Peri-peri cauliflower, sir.
Peri-peri cauliflower.
That's very nice.
Yeah, gobi.
Yes, gobi.
Gobi on a pizza. Well, let's try it. And as far as the main course goes, I leave that to the chef. If I can make a request that, I want to taste all these flavors, so if I could have smaller portions.
Very well, I'd
thank you.
Thank you very much.
Can't wait to get to the dishes. So of course earlier the Oberoi, they would come and place the serviette on your lap, but in the new norm where zero contact is advisable to the extent possible, you help yourself to the serviette. So I got two of my appetizers here. So this is the goat cheese brulee, as delicate, as dainty as it can get. And then you have that Karari Rumali Roti, which looks the exact opposite of this goat cheese brulee in its personality. This looks delicate, this looks pretty, and that looks robust, almost masculine when you compare it to the brulee. Let's taste the brulee first. So this is a brulee, it's a custard, a baked custard made of goat cheese. And on top, you have a glaze, and I'm told that's passion fruit. And you also have some sabza seeds or the basil seeds. And then you've got some beetroot, some grapefruit, some oranges as well on the side. And then you have some reduced balsamic vinaigrette. The brulee dissolves away on your palate, leaving behind a certain smokiness. And then there's the acidity, the tartness that comes from the passion fruit glaze that's on top of the brulee. I want to taste the beetroot first just by itself. There's a spicy sourness to that beetroot. So I suppose that's the pickled beetroot. Go over some of that brulee with that beetroot. So that's a great yin and yang sort of a combination on the palate. You have the lush, tender, melt in the mouth creaminess of that goat cheese brulee. And then you have that spicy pickled fervor of the beetroot. That's a granola and flaxseed chip. almost like a brittle. The sweetness of that chip resets your palate. I'm going to go for a bite of the brulee, the goat cheese brulee with the beetroot, some of that balsamic, and also a wedge of the orange. You first taste the creaminess of the goat cheese brulee, and then the puckering acidity of that balsamic, and also that spicy fervor of the pickled beetroot. What I definitely want to be doing is chasing that with that granola chip. I think this is a great dish to begin your meal with. You've got some fat in terms of the cheese, and then you've got the fruit and also the vegetable in the beet. There's an interesting play of flavors and textures in the mouth. You know, that's the sort of appetizer that gets all the juices flowing and gets you ready for the meal ahead. On which note, I'm going to taste some of that karari rumali roti. I think this is easily the sort of dish that makes for a bit of a conversation starter. I don't know where to begin, but we'll begin somewhere. Ah, I love the crunch of that kadak rumali. So there's definitely a fair bit of butter that you see glistening away. And then of course some spices, perhaps the chili or the paprika. And then some herbs, a light sprinkling of some herbs, probably some coriander that's gone into it. It is served with three dips here. I think this is the beetroot dip, and then we have a mango dip and a masala yogurt. The first thing that you taste is all the butter that's been ladled onto this upside down, ulta tawa, paratha style rumali roti. And then you taste the spicy aggression of that chili powder. There's definitely tons of chili powder in that. So what you need to do probably is go for some of the dip. I'm going to begin with that beetroot dip. That beetroot dip definitely has some acidity. You can taste that the yogurt is a bit sour. I think there's some kala namak that's gone into that beetroot dip. This, I was told, is a raw mango dip. You can definitely taste the puckering tartness of the raw mango in that. Khattapan of that raw mango dip. Personally, I find that a bit too sour. If you love your curry, definitely a great combination. I think this yogurt dip should probably help calm things down. All that you have in that yogurt dip is of course that creamy yogurt. I think some onion, ginger that you bite into, and some masala, some spices. As you break off bits of the bread and taste it with the three chutneys that they have here, and each one speaking to your palate in a completely different direction, well, that is certainly bound to get a conversation going. My personal favorite, that yogurt with masala dip. What they also do now here as part of the new normal is that almost every dish comes to you with the cloche, with the covering. So from the time that it leaves the chef's station till the point that it's brought in front of the guest, it's covered. Well, we're moving things up on the flavor perspective. So what we have next is the Hyderabadi Keema Tikki. So this is a lamb mince. So it's a kache keeme ki tikki in the sense that the mince is not cooked before it's made into the tikki. So it's the raw meat mince that's shallow fried, I suppose, on a tawa to make this tikki. Of course, the tikki is served with two chutneys. So you have a mint chutney here. And then you have that raw mango, that curry ki chutney. I think I'm going to stay away from that curry ki chutney. I found that a little too sour for my palate. I love the char on the tikki, and that will give it a certain depth when it comes to flavor. I love the pink of the meat. The meat is soft. And as you bite into the meat releases its juices. And then you have the crunch of the onions, the fresh crunch of the onions. There's also some coriander in that that I can taste, and some of the warming spices. That meat, that keema is moist. It needs no chutney actually. Just some pyaz or onions with it. Give me a piece of bread, give me a rumali or a roti with this. Some lacha pyaz, some onions. That's all that you need to have a great, satisfying meal going. I'm going to taste it with some of that mint chutney since we have the chutney on the plate. I like the fact that the sticky almost breaks down as you try to hold it. It basically tells me that this tikki is all meat. There's no binder that's gone in to glue it all together. This is a tikki that's 100% meat, and that's the reason why it breaks down as you try to hold it, which is what makes it all the more meaty and juicy. I can taste some of the spices. I can taste the coriander, some jeera, some cumin. You know, the depth of flavor, the spices that I taste in this kimege tikki, also with that warmth that I can taste from the chili, actually reminds me of a good Hyderabadi pattar ka gosht. So in a good Hyderabadi pattar ka gosht, you have that depth of flavor, you have all the spices, and that's what this tikki reminds me of. They call it a Hyderabadi kimege tikki. I guess the inspiration for this is probably the Hyderabadi pattar ka gosht. That's a delicious tikki. Kache kheme ki tikki. What I really like about dining here, and especially in the current scenario, is that it doesn't really feel like you're dining inside in an air-conditioned restaurant. Sure, the restaurant is air-conditioned and they have the temperature going at 24 or 25 degrees, but all the doors are open. So as you sit here, you really feel like you're dining in, but al fresco. Out here, you don't just have a view of the outdoors, but you also have all that fresh air coming into the restaurant. Lovely. Oh, that looks nice. Well, this is an all-day dining restaurant with cuisines that straddles multiple countries. And now we've traveled to the US, more specifically Chicago, to try the deep dish pizza that's served here at Lapis. And this is the roasted cauliflower with peri-peri spices. Suffice to say, after this meal, I certainly am not making plans for dinner. That's a loaded pizza. It certainly feels weighty too. So you got tons of cheese. You got that cheese literally dripping over. I'm told there's some roasted cauliflower in a peri-peri spice that's somewhere in there. You know, when you're tasting a deep dish pizza, you want that pizza to be almost crunchy at the base, because that base of that pizza has to hold the weight of all the fillings of the cheese that's gone into this deep dish pizza, and this pizza certainly has that crunch. It's a bit of a mess when you're eating a deep dish pizza using your hand, but there's something about eating a pizza with your hand. You can taste the cauliflower that's in the pie, and also I think some jalapeno. You definitely have some spicy tartness of that jalapeno. That's a loaded pizza with the cheese, with the stuffing. Have a couple of slices of this, and that's pretty much your main course in a meal here. So if you're ordering the deep dish pizza here, order it, but order it with some friends. So therefore you have a slice of that deep dish pizza, but then you're also able to taste some of the other dishes that this restaurant has to offer. Let's taste it now with some of that lapis topping. So I'm told this has rosemary, this has chili flakes, this has some parmesan. This pizza is complete in all the flavor that it delivers to your palate. But since they have this lapis seasoning, I thought we should taste some. You definitely taste the rosemary and the spike of the chili that's in that seasoning, but then you also taste the savory creaminess of the parmesan. That's also a part of that seasoning. And then they have some truffle olive oil. If you want to top your pizza with more decadence, I'm eating out after a long time, so why not? You smell the heady aroma of that truffle infused oil even before you taste the pizza. And when you taste the pizza, you're tasting the topping, you're tasting the cheese, you're tasting the spicing of that peri-peri, but then you're tasting the smoky flavors of that truffle-infused olive oil. Well, that's definitely a first for me, savoring a pizza with some truffle-infused olive oil. I love the deep, earthy aromas of the truffle. It's a mess, but a delicious mess. So we have a kale soup here, the organic kale soup, and with some ragi millets, and then you have the crisp with some avocado and amaranth, or the rajgira. So kale is a foreign vegetable actually. So I think it's in the same family as the cabbage. It's not a vegetable that's native to India. I suppose they grow it here now, that's why they have it. And then you have the millets, the ragi. There's a nutty bitterness to the soup. It's a sort of soup that tastes healthy. It's not a soup that's designed to pander to your taste buds. This is a soup that says, I'm healthy, drink me. And that's what this soup is all about. So you're tasting the herbaceousness of that kale with its slight bitter edge. The rajgira and the millets help in adding a bit of a bite to your palate. Certainly is a soup that tastes wholesome. Let's try some of that crisp now with the avocado and amaranth. I think there's also a bit of lemon in that avocado. It gives it a zesty tang. Now the soup is nourishing, the soup is wholesome, but it's not the sort of soup that I want to be ordering when I'm dining out. Nothing wrong with the soup, but just that when you go out to eat, I want to order a soup that feels like a bit of a tasty indulgence, especially if you're eating out after 3 months. I don't mind wellness, but I want wellness to come in with a healthy dose of taste. This one is wellness all right, but doesn't do much for me on the taste department. Well, it's time now to move on to the main course, and we have two main courses that we're going to taste. But green seems to be the theme, so we have this Calcutta Bekti, the sea bass. It's in a coconut sort of a broth, and then you have some cilantro dressing on top, some coriander based dressing, some wilted spinach on the side, and some sweet potato crisps. And then on the Indian front, we have a panchkutta saag. This, I'm told, is an amalgam of 5 greens. So there's a Malabar spinach, there's spinach, so there's red amaranth, there's green amaranth, and also I think some coriander that goes into it. Topped, of course, with some garlic pods and makhan. Served with a chur chur paratha and some yellow dal. But I think I'm going to taste the fish first. The fish is cooked perfectly, the fish is moist, and then topping the fish, you have a salsa with cilantro or coriander. I love the crisp sear of the fish. That fish has a bit of a crunch. Let's now taste the fish with the Creole spiced coconut broth. So that Creole spiced coconut broth is gentle, gentle in its spicing, but more on the sweeter side. Let's taste some of that wilted spinach. That wilted spinach definitely brings its deep, slightly bitter, savory notes. You have a cilantro marinade on top with some chilies, but that's not enough for the fish to offset the sweetness of the sauce. When you taste the sauce just by itself, that sauce seems to be a tad too sweet when paired with the fish. But when you add some of that spinach lends its almost meaty, savory character to round off all the flavors. Let's taste the panchkutta saag next. So you've got the greens, you've got the butter. I think I'm going to mix the butter into that green along with some of that garlic and crest it with some of that toasted garlic. I'm going to taste with that chur chur paratha. It's similar to the parotta of the south, but this chur chur parotta is made with wheat. Let's taste that parotta with the panchkutta saag. This is the sort of greens that I like. It's healthy, it's got 5 greens in there. It's got the Malabar spinach, the regular spinach, the red amaranth, the green amaranth, and the coriander. And then you have that seasoning, that tadka. I think it's a tadka of jeera that you taste, and that white butter, and the pungency of the garlic that brings it all together. That certainly is a tasty, wholesome saag. I think we should also taste some of that dal, some of that yellow dal. That dal is thick and creamy. I think again it's a combination of various lentils and a tasty one of that. My chur chur parotta is chur chur, but I'm quite enjoying it with that saag.
So unbelievable apple.
Oh wow. Well, we have two very luscious looking desserts here. This one certainly looks pretty, and this is the unbelievable apple. I'm told this is a cinnamon mousse with some apple jelly, and then of course you have a walnut ice cream here. And this is a gluten-free vegan dessert which is called the Pot of Gold, made of guava and some berry compote that you see on top with some crumble. I think we're going to taste the unbelievable apple first. So you taste the sweetness of that apple jelly and then the mildly spiced creaminess or that cinnamon mousse. And then the full-on flavors of the spiced apple. This certainly is a clever take on an apple crumble. And then you have some walnut ice cream, and then you also have some chocolate soil here, which is fine. But what's really interesting is the combination of that apple jelly, cinnamon mousse, and the center of spiced apple bits. Certainly a dessert that you must try when you're here at Lapis at the Oberoi Bengaluru. Now that we are done with the unbelievable apple, time to go for the Pot of Gold. Let's see what lurks within this Pot of Gold. Certainly is a delicious looking dessert, and which is the first thing that you really want of a dessert. You want that dessert to invite you to devour it as soon as you spot it, and that's what these desserts are all about. So there's multiple layers here. You've got the berry compote, you've got that pink guava jelly, and there's some almond cream somewhere in the middle. So this is a vegan dessert. I think I'm going to try and taste most of this Pot of Gold in one spoonful, if I can do that. You taste the fruitiness of that pink guava right away. That's straddled in between layers of that creamy almond milk. It's almost like a panna cotta in its texture. And the berry compote with its acidity serves to break the monotony of sweetness that's coming from the guava and the creaminess of that almond milk. Well, I had to step out for a cup of coffee after that indulgent meal. Well, I've lost track of the number of dishes that I tasted, right from that ulta tawa karari rumali roti to that lush creamy goat cheese brulee and that delicious kache keme ki Hyderabadi tikki. And of course, we had to have a nutritious element to it, so we had the organic kale soup, but not before that indulgent deep dish pizza. Main course too was interesting in two different directions. So we had the sea bass with a delicate Creole spiced sauce, and then we had a hearty local panchkuta saag with five greens that went into it. And dessert was something else altogether. I think that Pot of Gold was special, but that unbelievable apple blew me away. I had to wrap up my meal with a cup of coffee sitting out here in the gardens of the Oberoi Bengaluru, because that's what dining at this hotel is all about. You may be sitting in one of the restaurants, but all around you is verdant greenery. And because of the fact that the doors are open, it's almost like you're dining out in the great outdoors. From what we've seen, there's a lot that's happening here at the Oberoi Bengaluru to ensure that guests can dine in complete safety and in peace of mind. The measures begin long before the guests arrive at the hotel. It begins when the ingredients find their way to the hotel, where they are only allowed into the kitchen after multiple checks. In the kitchen too, everybody is socially distanced. They're wearing a mask. And then there's a bell that goes off every 30 minutes, reminding chefs to wash their hands and disinfect, sanitize once again. Even as you drive into the Oberoi, your car is sanitized. You sanitize your hands. Your belongings are sanitized before you find your way to the restaurant. At the restaurant, all doors are open, allowing for fresh air to come inside, and every other table cordoned off for seating to ensure that guests are socially distanced. So there's a lot that's happening here in terms of visible measures and also behind the scenes to ensure that guests can indeed have a safe dining experience. It's been 3 months since we last ate out, and I'm glad we picked the Oberoi Bengaluru for this Gourmet on the Road episode. I hope you enjoyed the episode. Until the next one, stay safe, stay very, very safe, and happy eating. If you'd like to support the work that we do at Food Lovers TV, do consider joining our membership community on YouTube by hitting the join button below or on the homepage. You could pledge a nominal sum and receive special privileges like behind the scenes footage, shoot updates, access to live Q&As, and a lot more. You could support us on a Patreon page as well. For more info, check out the links in the description below. If you like this video, don't forget to subscribe, like, share, and leave a comment below. Happy eating!